Macmillan Audio presents Promise Boys, written by Nick Brooks, read by Renier Cortes, Christopher Hampton, Alfred Vines, Hannah Church, Suehyla El-Attar Young, Maria Liatis, Anthony Michael Lopez, Eliana Marianes, Brad Sanders, Jaime Lincoln Smith, Xenia Willacey, and Henriette Zoutomou. I've noticed a fascinating phenomenon in my 25 years of teaching, that schools and schooling are increasingly irrelevant to the great enterprises of the planet. No one believes anymore that scientists are trained in science classes or politicians in civics classes or poets in English classes. The truth is that schools don't really teach anything except how to obey orders. This is a great mystery to me because thousands of humane, caring people work in schools as teachers and aides and administrators, but the abstract logic of the institution overwhelms their individual contributions. Although teachers do care and do work very hard, the institution is psychopathic. It has no conscience. It rings a bell, and the young man in the middle of writing a poem must close his notebook and move to a different cell where he must memorize that man and monkeys derive from a common ancestor. John Taylor Gatto, Why Schools Don't Educate.
Breaking news. Beloved principal killed at 43. D.C. police are investigating a homicide in Northeast D.C. Mr. Kenneth Moore, founder and principal of Urban Promise Prep, was shot to death on school premises on Friday, October 10. He was a beloved member of the community. A co-worker found Moore's body early Friday evening and called 911. When officers arrived, they discovered Moore with a single gunshot wound to the temple. He was pronounced dead on the scene. Detectives have been working to establish a suspect or suspects and motive in this case, and it's reported they have already detained three students for questioning. Anyone with information is asked to call the District of Columbia Police Department's Homicide Unit at 202-555-4925. A reward of up to $65,000 is offered to anyone who provides information leading to an arrest and indictment in this case. Part 1. J.B. Present Day.
Nobody. Urban Promise Prep student. Rumor has it a student brought a gun to school the day of the murder. You didn't hear that from me.
Kiana Glenn. Anacostia High School student. We can't believe the things we see. We can only believe the things we feel. I thought I could believe in JB because I could feel how much he liked me. Or at least I thought I could, until he stood me up. The day after we got so close. When he had told me he'd meet me after school and we'd go to the game together. That we'd be together, officially. He swore he was different, not like other guys, better than them. And against my gut feeling, he convinced me to trust him. And maybe I still do, but my head's a mess, and I don't know anything right now. Ugh, I feel like such a fool. I got used, or tricked. Now I feel bad about myself, and that ain't fair. Even thinking about it pisses me off. Every time I close my eyes, the night plays over and over again. Me dragging myself to the game all alone, ready to confront JB. But when I arrived, I saw him covered in blood. I froze right there in the school doorway. We both did. Everything I'd wanted to scream at him bubbled up, getting stuck in my mouth. The blood. My thoughts raced. Did he get hurt? Was that the reason he hadn't picked me up like he said he would? Is that why he hadn't called or texted me back?
It wasn't my fault,
he whispered, while trying to catch his breath. He then took off. He clearly wasn't injured, not moving that fast. He disappeared into the darkness of the evening. Of course, at the time, I didn't know about Principal Moore. Everyone's saying JB killed that man. But I mean, part of me can't believe that. On the other hand, I know what I saw. JB with blood all over his shirt and his words replaying over and over again in my head. It wasn't my fault. Every time I start to believe in something, I'm reminded that everyone around here is so fake. I guess you never truly know a person. I hope I'm wrong. I hope JB is innocent.
Nurse Robin, Urban Promise Prep employee. Don't get me wrong, I care about the work. It's this place that I can't stand. When I told my friends I'd be working at Urban Promise Prep, they all warned me about it being all male, but I figured I could handle it. I have to deal with nasty men 24 hours a day. Every school I've worked at, every bus ride, every stroll down the street, every grocery trip, men hit on me. Why would Promise Prep be any different? Right? Wrong. At Urban Promise, I was incredibly uncomfortable, nervous. You know the feeling. Principal Moore created a boiling pot of toxic masculinity and male fragility. You think I'm talking about the students, but no. The kids are kids. They don't know any better. It's the adults, the teachers, the security guards, the leadership. They encouraged the behavior. Last year, a boy circulated some inappropriate video he made with a young girl, so the security guard searched his things and confiscated his phone. It was the right thing to do. But he never actually got detention or suspension, not even a slap on the wrist. And worse, I saw the guards in the break room passing around the dang phone, watching the thing before they deleted it, snickering over literal child pornography, cracking jokes about the young lady in the video. They didn't even think twice. Just no sense of morality when it came to women at Urban Promise. But Moore didn't care about that. As long as the boys were in line, these men could act a fool. You know, Moore is so pristine in the public eye, but he wasn't squeaky clean either. He did the little things like hug me too long or put his hand on the small of my back when he spoke to me in the hall. Also, call me ridiculous or whatever, but I swear he had an alcohol problem. I've treated plenty of patients with drinking habits, and Moore fit the bill. His mood would change at the drop of a dime. Sometimes smooth as silk, charming and gregarious, supportive and kind. Then other times, I've seen him snap at kids, snap at teachers, even snap at Dean Hicks. And lately, it had been worse than usual. Anyway, guess you could say I don't think it's as much of a loss as other people do. As far as the boys they're questioning about his murder, I didn't really know them, but I did see JB the day of the shooting. He came to me to get his hand bandaged. He scraped it pretty bad after punching something. What happened? I asked him. His fists were clenched tight, like he was trying to dig his nails into his own skin, the deep brown of it threaded with blood. Nothing, he mumbled. Can't be nothing if you're here with your hand looking like this. I tried to smile at him, make him more comfortable since his knuckles were so shredded. I did my best to clean the wound, but he wouldn't loosen his hand. Not the entire time he sat in the office. He just glared off into the distance, jaw clenched, like he couldn't wait to do something more with that messed up fist. I walked backward to my desk before telling him he could leave. A weird instinct came over me. I didn't want to turn my back to him. Not with the anger radiating off him like heat. Like he could swing again at any moment. His hands needing a punching bag, something, anything to connect with in this moment. That's someone who is accustomed to violence. At that young age, makes me shudder. So, yeah, I'm looking for a new school to work at.
Becca Buckingham, Mercy Academy for Girls student. those poor boys, so full of anger. It's because of their life circumstances, though, right? I mean, imagine if you lived in poverty, were racially profiled, and a victim of systemic inequity. You would be too. That's why I choose to tutor at Promise, to make a difference. With my white privilege, I see it as my responsibility. But even with all that, I can't bring myself to understand why they'd kill Principal Moore, especially after all he's done for them. It's just a tragedy. They say they have 3 suspects. Everyone's been talking, and DC is smaller than you think. Word travels fast. I actually tutored one of them, Ramon Zambrano. Oh, Ramon is just the nicest kid. There's something angelic about him. I love how, like, authentic he is about his culture, making, I think it's called papooses, the little biscuit things. I heard he makes them with his grandma. I mean, how sweet is that? I went into overdrive trying to get him fluent in English because it'd help him land more opportunities. Not to mention, it was my duty. And Ramon really took to it. In fact, a few weeks ago, I would have said there's no way he did this. And a part of me still feels that in my heart. Though I saw, let's just say I heard he can have a temper. But there's hope for him. It's probably one of the other boys they arrested, like Trey Jackson. I never actually spoke to him, but I heard he was funny. A lot of the girls at Mercy thought he was hot. Plus, he plays basketball, so, you know. He might grow up and be in the NBA. Who wouldn't want to date that guy? Me. Athletes are douchebags, and I'm sure Trey's no different. Come to think of it, people called him a bully. He'd crack jokes on kids all the time, making himself feel big by making others feel small. But people also said he has, like, a military uncle with a bad attitude. Sometimes guys who have mean father figures turn out mean too, you know? At least he has a father figure, though. I don't know for sure, but I bet that's not very common with the boys at this school. And then there's J.B. Williamson. I don't know him any better than Trey, but I hear J.B. is pretty smart. I saw him a lot in the halls on tutoring days, and I mainly remembered him because he's huge, like 6'3", which tall guys are always sexy to me. But he never smiled. No matter how many times I smiled at him or said hi, he would just ignore me. That kind of gave me a weird feeling, you know? Everyone keeps asking me about that day at Promise. I'd been tutoring all afternoon in the ESL room. I'd stepped out to grab water, and there they were. JB and Principal Moore in a fight. I froze in place, along with everyone else. JB towered over Principal Moore, and there was a massive dent left behind in a locker. The tattered skin of JB's knuckles bled on the linoleum floor. I felt the tension from across the hall. JB bucked at Principal Moore, waiting for him to flinch or cower. But Principal Moore laughed, standing his ground. My heart rattled in my chest, and my pulse thundered so loud I didn't catch most of the argument. Principal Moore put his hand in the air, directing JB to walk away. And as JB stomped past me, all aggressive and angry, I heard him mumble, "I'ma see you." I'd heard boys at Promise say that before. It seemed like the last straw in a fight. As school security officers would pry them apart, they'd shout the phrase at each other over and over again. A warning. And without a doubt, later the gossip would travel to Mercy about the fights in the neighborhood with the Promise boys. But now, those 3 words echo in my head on repeat. A few hours after JB uttered them, Principal Moore turned up dead.
Unk. Neighborhood dude. I don't care about no damn principal. Principal don't care about me. Huh? That man never even looked me in my face like I ain't exist. Only time he spoke to me was to yell at me to leave from around the school. I'm from here. I was here first. What you talking about? Uppity-ass black folks taking over just like white folks. Welcome to the district, baby.
You see where I'm at. Long live Chocolate City.
Wilson Hicks, Urban Promise Prep, Dean of the Student Body. Oh God, I found him dead. Oh God, why'd it have to be me? I've never seen blood move like that. A red river rushing along the edges of the desk. Blank eyes stared back. I stepped closer and closer. Kenneth! Kenneth! My eyes scanned over his body. I couldn't tell where the blood came from. I covered my nose because the smell of feces in the air gave the death away. Kenneth had shit himself. I'd always heard that people shit themselves when they die, but thought it was nothing more than just a myth. I scrambled backward. I felt my face go red. Sweat poured down my temples. Questions raced through my head. What were those final moments like? How afraid had he been when the trigger was pulled? Did he feel much pain? Was he afraid to die? But I'll never have answers to those questions, even now, when that night starts playing over again in my head. It all comes rushing back. Could I have done something differently? Could I have prevented this from happening? Were we best friends? No. Technically, he was my boss. But when Kenneth set out to create Urban Promise Prep, he hired me first, and together, we built something truly remarkable. Say what you want about his methods, or mine even, but we got results. Sure, we showed the kids tough love, but we never crossed the line. We cared about these boys more than most, and all we wanted was the best for them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.